on behalf of the India International Center and the Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan Memorial Committee, I, Suhas Borker, trustee of the IISE, have the privilege to welcome you all to the first Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan Memorial Lecture. Ashok Vajpeyi, Professor Anvita Abbi, Dr. Subhash Malik ji, fellow members of IISE, ladies and gentlemen, we are honoring an institution within an institution today. We have three very distinguished personalities doing the honors today. Our speaker, Professor Anvita Abbi, distinguished linguist and scholar of tribal and minority languages of South Asia. B.B. Borker, Chair Professor of Comparative Literature, Goa University, Adjunct Professor, Department of Linguistics, Simon Fraser University, British Columbia, Vancouver, Canada, and formerly Professor of Linguistics, JNU. Our Chair, Ashok Vajpeyi, poet, essayist, literary, cultural critic, and eminent cultural and arts administrator. And there's a parallel between Kapila ji and Ashok Vajpeyi, which we will discover during the lecture. And Dr. Subhash Malik, renowned anthropologist and brother of Kapila ji, who shall give the closing remarks. For Kapila ji, India International Center became her karma bhumi after she became a life trustee of IISE in 1988. One day, Kamla Devi Chattopadhyay had called Kapila ji and told her, "When I go away and these trustees ask you to become a life trustee of IISE, please don't say no. If you do, I'll scream from wherever I am." That was how Kamala Devi sought and got commitment from her protege to serve IISE. Kapila ji became president of IISE from 1997 to 2001. And from 2003 onwards, she was the chairperson of the Asia project of IISE, later rechristened in 2016 as the International Research Division. And this was right till the end. Conferences, seminars, and exhibitions were tirelessly organized by her all through these years. N.H. Ramachandran, who is with us here, assisted her meticulously and loyally throughout her IISE innings. The IISE Asia project under Kapila ji's leadership produced seminal work ranging from Speaking for Myself, Anthology of Asian Women's Writing, and Sui Dhaga, Crossing Boundaries Through Needle and Thread, to Across the Himalayan Gap, A Chinese Quest for Understanding India, and Culture of Indigo in Asia, Plant, Product, and Power. She was undoubtedly disheartened when she came under personal attack with demands to close down the IISE Asia project. Once I remember asking Dr. Vatsyayan, "What would be left for posterity if an earthquake struck IISE?" Without waiting for an answer, I told her, "The books produced by your Asia project would be the only valuable asset to survive the calamity." And her face lit up with her inimitable smile. Kapila Vatsyayan was the grand matriarch of culture studies and a preeminent practitioner of the arts. Her life was the saga of a scholar practitioner of the arts who became a legend in her lifetime. She was beyond categorization as a scholar, dancer, linguist, author, ethnographer, educationist, or art historian. She never worked in silos and was an interdisciplinarian to the core. Her creativity as a performing artist and precision and insight as a scholar was molded into a vision of a cultural thinker and institution builder. Kapila ji was an integral part of the discourse of building cultural institutions in India for the last 60 years, a part of the cultural trinity with Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay and Pupul Jaikar. Some of the country's top institutions, which she was instrumental in establishing, were the Central Institute of Higher Tibetan Studies, Sarnath, Varanasi, Indira Gandhi Rashtriya Manav Sangrahalaya, Bhopal, Center for Cultural Resources and Training, Delhi, and the Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, Delhi. In 2008, she launched the Taking Children to Gandhi, TCTG program of the Working Group on Alternative Strategies at IIC, very much here in this hall. For the launch, we had screened a 40-minute documentary film, 30 January, Jagran or Gavai, which was made in 1991, which I had made with Ramchandra Gandhi on the significance of Gandhiji's martyrdom. The film left her with moist eyes, and she gave a very emotionally charged address to the students that day, recalling that she was dancing when she heard the ghastly news of Gandhiji's assassination, and with one ghungru still tied on her ankle, she rushed on her bicycle to Birla House and heard Nehru's memorable words, "The light has gone out of our lives and there is darkness everywhere." The TCTG program was conceptualized by me around the lives of Gandhi, King Mandela. And in these 15 years, minus 2 years, of course, of COVID, when we could not organize physical meetings, more than 12,000 students drawn from schools across Delhi NCR have joined this program at IIC. Many times, Dr. Vatsyayan would drop by unannounced and be flocked by students wanting to be photographed or selfied with the iconic legend they had only heard about. Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan relentlessly pursued the project of making IIC into a thought space. And she was the keeper of the liberal, democratic, plural, inclusive, intellectual flame. And Kapilaji kept that flame alive for 32 long years till her last breath with single-minded devotion. Kapilaji's life and work shall be an inspiration for generations to come. I thank you.
Friends, it is difficult to imagine India International Center without the presence of Kapilaji. When we started using the center quite frequently, sometimes she would miss a talk in Art Matters, and then she will listen to the recording and either ring me up or write a letter as to what she felt about that particular session. You know, Kapilaji, as has been mentioned, was many persons in one. And that's an astounding phenomena. I would call her Saptavarni, you know, if on playing upon the Saptaparni. So she was a scholar, she was a dancer, and had received training from some of the best gurus of her time. She was a culture thinker. She was an art administrator. She was an institution maker. She was a writer. And she was a member of parliament, all rolled into one. Delhi's cultural and intellectual ethos owes much to Kapilaji's initiatives, promotion, and patronage. Her concern related to intellectual richness of India, its living traditions of arts, a resistance to the West-propelled modernity, support towards rejuvenation of both classical and folk traditions. Her vision included emphasis on the localness of the arts, their rootedness and vitality. Text, for her, lived in context only. Many institutions, such as Sangeet Bharati, IGNCA, IIC, etc., some of them were founded by her, and some of them were nurtured by her. In recognition of her contribution, the Raza Foundation decided to commission a biography of Kapilaji. There's a young curator now working in Kiran Nadar Museum. Her name is Aditi Ghidalyal, who's researching and finally would be writing a biography of Kapilaji. The Raza Foundation is also planning to hold a major seminar on the contribution and vision of Kapilaji sometime next year. Our speaker today is an important linguist, scholar, and language activist, a teacher, and has also done very arduous and detailed field work. Her work on and for languages of the Andaman group of islands and other minority languages has been recognized globally. Many years, I recall, I, in my several bouts of foolishness, requested her to carry out a linguistic survey. We wanted to start a new linguistic survey of India. Quite madness, no? And then she agreed. And for the beginning, we thought we'll give two small states, Chhattisgarh and, was it Jharkhand? Or whatever it was. And of course, as soon as I left the job, the project came to almost an end. Anyway, so may I request now Professor Anita Abbi? Oh, yeah. There's Subhash here, there's Suhas there. There's some kind of a rhyme.
She'll be giving on the screen. I'm sorry for dislocation. फिल्म में आएगा ना तो ठीक है Some people are tall themselves. Some people are made to look taller. So I'm one of the latter ones. I needed a platform to be here. I'm very thankful to the committee of Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan Memorial Lecture Committee to give me the opportunity and the honor of being the very first
of the very first person to give this talk to this August audience. But before I begin, I would like to share with you that perhaps, I may be wrong, that after Subhashji, I am the only person who have known Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan the longest. Subhash, being her brother, of course, has spent many years together. And my memory is very vivid, but it comes in three phases. The first phase, when I was a little child, growing up in Allahabad, Kapilaji and Mr. Vatsyayan were very good friends of my parents, Bharat Bhushan Agrawal and Bindu Agrawal. And I came to know of Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan at that time. And we were really in awe and struck with her beautiful smile, grace, and loving nature. Then in the second phase, I remember that when we moved to Delhi, I was a teenager. At that time, she was busy working on Natya Shastra and many other forms of dance. And she was, of course, as Ashokji has just said, she started building the cultural capital of this country and in various institutes and organizations and so on and so forth. But in last 30 years, we again came very close because she came to know that I go to remote villages and I work on especially those languages which are on the verge of extinction or they are marginalized, they have been on margins, so they have not been studied very much or they have not been exposed very much. And every time she used to say, when you come back from your fieldwork, you must come and meet me. So I used to share my experiences with her and it became almost like a routine that I must tell her what happened. And in that, that memory is more in my mind now, and this culminated into an international, it was into really an international seminar of South Asia and Southeast Asian scholars on linguistic diversity. And we edited a book, which I think is displayed outside. You can have a look at that. So these were the, because these memories were so vivid in my mind, I have chosen my topic really in commemorating to her memory and her dignity and her multifaceted personality, but above all, the kind of work and the research that had interested her very much. And most of the research results that I'm presenting in front of you today are the ones that I had already shared with her. To begin with, let me tell you that, I mean, there are people in audience, I'm sure they know about linguistics, but I'll start with the very beginning. You know, we are linguists. We love all kinds of languages, living, thriving, dying, and those that have become extinct. We love those who speak these languages or have ever spoken these languages. Languages are made up of organized structures, which we call grammar. Grammar is constructed of a well-organized set of rules. The rules that we learned, or the rules that are shared between speaker or hearer, or between two signers, because there are sign languages. There are more than 50 million signers in this country. All that we speak or sign is a representation of codes. Codes that are internalized by our brains when we start learning these languages. Yes, when we started learning, when we were infants, still cuddled in the arms of our mothers. Yes, no one taught us the rules of grammar, but we all learned them from limited data set that we were exposed to as a child. When we grow up and try to learn a second or third language, we are taught rules of grammar, which becomes a tedious process. Something so easy in early childhood that we all picked up naturally becomes difficult. So what do linguists do? They try to open the knots of the spoken languages even when they do not speak that language, we unearth the language structures because we know that language is a rule-governed phenomenon, and once we get hold of a rule, we know how a speaker in that language generates a meaningful sentence, not one or two, but infinite. Why language structures are so mesmerizing? What is so interesting about them that linguists are attracted to studying new, existing, old, and sometimes those languages that are no longer spoken? Well, language is a very big representation of our culture, civilization, paths of human migration, beliefs, ethos, values, power of judgment, and the biggest clue of how we conceive and perceive the world around us. And that's a very important factor. Yes, the cognitive abilities of a speech community are reflected in its language and its structure. No forensic science can match us. What we find out by just analyzing a language, you will need a team of historians, population geneticists, psychologists, anthropologists, sociologists, and environmentalists combined to match us. Why? Because we know the nature of each language and its functions. We know what speaker speaks to whom, where, and when. We are like speech detectives, the biggest spies ever born on this earth. And each unit of grammar speaks to us about the history and cultural beliefs of the community. So linguistics, I find, is the biggest life science, because our investigation starts when the child is in the womb and goes on to the twilight years of one's life and beyond, when the speaker or signer ceases to exist. So when anyone asks me, oh, you are a linguist, how many languages do you know or speak? I get very irritated because, or sometimes I take pity on the ignorance of the person who asked me this question. Do you ever ask a doctor how many diseases does he have? You never do, right? You only are interested that he should know about the diseases and how to cure them, what are the cause and effects. Similarly, why then we are asked this question? Linguists know a lot about languages, about their structures, how they are formed, and how they are changed. Some of us are specialists, just like a doctor, or some of us know also the other areas of linguistics, and of course, some of us know several fields of linguistics, just like you have many specialists as a doctor, and you also have very interconnected disciplines in medicine like ENT, eyes, nose, and throat doctors. In short, we are taught how to dissect the language so that we unearth everything about its speakers. I'll give you a small example of how languages encodes your environment, your culture, your beliefs, and contact with others or outsiders. You see, the Great Andamanese language has six different words for seashore. So suppose you meet a Great Andamanese in Delhi or in Hyderabad. Just by his knowledge of six different words for seashore, you will get to know the geographical location of that speech community. So you don't have to ask where does he come from. Of course, he's either a seafarer or very close to the life where he has to meet the sea every day, because in any of our languages, we don't have many words, more than two words for seashores, but they have different gradations of seashores. Similarly, Great Andamanese also have very good hunters, or they were very good hunters. So they have six different words for the opening of the forest. And I did not know that the opening of the forest had so many gradations. So the words themselves emote the geographical location of the community that spoke the language. I had a very good opportunity in last 5 to 6 years to work on two endangered languages of the Nicobar Islands. And I remember that when we were working on Luro, the language spoken on Terrace Island, I had the good fortune of spending some time by the seashore. And I realized that the language has four different kinds of what equivalent to English there. So one there is used when to refer to somebody who's on the island. Another there is used when somebody is on an adjacent island. Another there is used when somebody is in Port Blair city. Or there's another fourth there, which basically refers to somebody who's in, let's say, very far, let's say, New Delhi. So four different location words for there they have. And this is a clue to give us their kind of culture and the kind of perception they have about the distances. I remember I worked on one of the, displaced or migrant community of Romas. They are also commonly known as gypsies in Heidelberg when I was visiting professor there. And I realized that, Romas migrated from India, specifically from Punjab in 13th century. And I was surprised even after 700 years, the basic word stock of the language remained the same. The only change that came was in the way they construe their sentences, that is the syntax. So the your Roma is very much like a European language, only in sentences. But they have words like mar, khao, pi, pan, pra, for the kind of relations, brother and sister, and other the basic verbs. So the migration pattern of these languages, which are displaced from their original location, can also be deciphered by the linguists. There's another aspect that we generally and very commonly deal with, the social organization. How do we know about the social organization of a community? I will give you a very simple example that in most of the languages of India, and specifically in Hindi, Urdu, you have three different second person pronouns, tu, tum, or aap. Now, why do we need these three pronouns? Of course, there's the whole society is so hierarchically organized that we do need these pronouns for various reasons, not only just to show the hierarchy, but also there's a whole social dynamics of the pronouns to show intimacy level to the formality level. So the language emotes so many aspects, but most, and one of the important research that is going on these days is on language contact. The structures of language reveals various kinds and the intensity of the contact with other speech communities. The India International Center recently had an exquisite lecture by Professor Klaus Peter Zoller just a few weeks ago. And his intensive research on the small Himalayan languages, and when I say Himalayan languages, I mean he drew the examples from all the three language family, the Tibeto-Burman, the Indo-Aryan languages, and also there are some Austroasiatic remains there. So he proved that the Austroasiatic influence were there in the Indo-Aryan and Tibeto-Burman languages, and especially in Indo-Aryan languages, there was the words that he found do not, they are not attested in Vedic Sanskrit and its dialects. Meaning thereby, he carefully analyzed a large data set which showed that there was another migration of the Indo-Aryan speakers which preceded the Vedic speech community. So this was a very groundbreaking research. I do not know how many of you had the chance to listen to him, but this was very interesting that how language exposed the whole set of old Indo-Aryan migration which predates the Vedic period. Now, if a language is so important, in our lives, we must ensure that it survives, prolongs, and grows as long as humanly possible. Human beings are programmed to learn language from birth, the unique gift only given to humans, as we are all born with FOXP2 gene. No other species, no other primates, no other, on the species on this earth is born with FOXP2 gene, which is responsible for learning a language. So it's innate. Unfortunately, human languages are dying at an alarming speed, to the tune of almost one language ceases to exist every fortnight. It is surprising that the world is concerned about the endangered species, endangered flora, fauna, but not much or not at all before endangered languages. We know that India is known for linguistic diversity because we have six language families represented here. And I was fortunate enough to identify the sixth language family, which was Great Andamanese. But you know, the traces of seventh language family are also visible. And that also exists in Andaman, the Onges and Jarvas. So our country not only houses one of the oldest language families of the world, which is Great Andamanese, it also houses seven different language families, each diverse in its own way, and they have a different historical backgrounds. As we know, all languages are vibrant and can be vibrant, but not all languages are vibrant and kicking fit. And some have the shrunk in their domains, some only are spoken at home. And as Zuckerman said, some are sleeping beauties. That means nobody revives them, but yes, if you poke a community, they do wake up and start speaking or at least remembering the language. So the loss of hundreds of languages that have already passed into oblivion is an intellectual catastrophe. And this catastrophe is as big in magnitude as you can think of, because I think it is bigger than an ecological catastrophe that we face today, as the Earth's tropical forests, as you know, are swept by fire and human intervention. But language continues to be the greatest treasure of humanity. And it also enhances our cognitive abilities. It captures our cognitive abilities because it codes in language, but it also enhances our cognitive abilities because our perception is reflected in the word that we use. And I will start from here. I'll show you that how the cognitive abilities are also decreased if the language loses those words. You know, there were 9 different words in the South American Maya language for the color blue. So there were 9 different shades of blue, actually, which people could specify because there were 6 different kind species of butterflies they could see in the forest. But when the Spanish prepared the bilingual dictionary of Porua Spanish Maya dictionary, only 3 Spanish translations occurred, leaving 6 butterflies that can be seen only by the Maya, proving beyond doubt that when its language dies, 6 butterflies disappear from the consciousness of the people. So those 6 shades of blue completely got evaporated from the cognition. So the second and third generation does not even perceive the difference between one shade of blue from another. Similarly, there is another coming back closer to home. We have interesting linguistic structures which we call expressives. They are actually created by duplicating a, you can say, nonsense syllable, but they are not nonsense because they have large and very deep meaning words. The words that exist most largely in the Himalayan languages of Tibeto-Burman and also the Austroasiatic languages like Khasi, Panar, where I started my career of actually working on the languages in villages in 1977. And the structures of the emote various kind of manner of an action. Now look at this. This is a Khasi. These are Khasi examples. Yai din khasi means to walk. But imagine how many ways can you walk in Khasi. There are 59 ways you can express your walk. So be very careful when you walk in Shillong, because there, the community is watching you. So this bak-bak, if you say yait bak-bak, it means go hurriedly. If you say yait biang-biang, it means walk continuously. If you say yait bran-bran, it means go very fast, and so on and so forth. But look at this, yait kning-kning, walk lamely as if one tired, or if there's a stone in the sole. Or kijik-kijik, walk on pins. There are a lot more. I have just brought a few examples, but they also tell you the range of perception of the society about walk. And walk is not the only action that they classify in so many ways. They have 57 different ways of crying. So the word for cry is yam, and it has, again, something similar that I'm showing you here. And similarly, they have 38 different ways of speaking and 20 different ways of eating. And if you look into your own languages, I'm sure you will also find some words for manner of eating, but not beyond 5 or 6. But they have 28, and I'm sure they have many more. But what I would like to bring to your notice that in the modern generation, these constructions are not used. So the current Khasi speakers or Jayanti or Panar speakers do not make use of expressive as much as they used to. And it's not just in Austroasiatic languages, Khasi and Panar, that these exist. Look at the Tibeto-Burman languages like Tangkhul Naga. Something exactly similar, kazat means to walk, and you have so many ways of kazat. So you can have yang yai kazat, shing shing kazat. So, and you see, there are very interesting meaning. If you look into the meaning, actually, these are very difficult to translate. And Ashok Vajpeyi is sitting here, and I'm very happy that I could bring these slides to show him that, I mean, it is a challenge to translate these, because it's, number one, you do not have a mono word to translate in your language. Another thing is that you don't even have expressive morphemes or expressive words to have such a variety of different manners. See, look at this, nut nut kazat, to walk non-progressively with frequent backward motions as while forcing to go by pushing or dragging. It's, so you know, I have to explain it in such a large sentence. So this is an interesting aspect that the perception, how the perception of a community's actions are coded in the language. We also have, actually, expressive morphology or expressive words are very common to emote Panchendriya in most of the languages of in the central India or in Hindi. For example, the sense of smell, sight, touch, and hearing and taste, like gamgamana in Mathili, or chamcham, glittering in Hindi, or las-las, sticky in Punjabi, or khe-khe, you know, sound, laughter in Metei, Manipuri, or tok-tok, like laughing sound, and many others. So this is quite common. The other interesting aspect is that the languages have a power of storing the secrets of survival, but also the knowledge. You know, on 26 December 2004, when the Indian tsunami struck back the shores of Andaman Nicobar, exactly 20 years before today. Today is also 26 December. All three Andamanese tribes, Onge, Jarawa, and Great Andamanese, were fishing by the sea because it came early in the morning. They all saved themselves while India lost more than 7,000 lives just in Andaman and Nicobar alone. I remember now Junior told me that, who was a great Andamanese person hailing from that community, he was my friend, my guru. He said, Sare ukku boroko. That's how he shouted, because the sea, what it meant that the sea has turned upside down. He could see those fishes which reside in the twilight zone of sea come up. So he expressed it as if the sea has turned upside down. What he, and of course he warned everybody to go inside into the forest. Onges shouted Gyang Jebe, that means the land has become water, and that prompted everybody to go again as deep into the forest as others. And so did Jarawa, you know, could recognize the pattern of the waves and immediately save themselves from being drowned in tsunami. So the power of language is such that everything connects with everything. The, what is, this is known as a, what we conceive as, that language is a bicultural hybrid. It's a coevolutionary approach, a product of intensive gene culture coevolution over perhaps the last 200,000 to 400,000 years. The main reason why we are so much concerned of the fact that the linguistic diversity is decreasing at an alarming speed. This also brings us close to the fact that even this great Andamanese language, which is known to be one of the older ones in India, had a very interesting classification of ethnobiological entities. I was surprised that they distinguished very clearly between the living and the non-living things, like Tajio and Elio, not living. And within Tajio, they have words for birds, Tajio Tutbech, that means the living things with feathers, Tajio Totchur, that means living things with scales, Tajio Chola, that means animals of the land, and Ishongo, that means us, the human body. And in the non-living, they have tong, trees and plants, in other words, the forest. So the because the language gives us so much power to emote, connect, and also to give information about our past, that some of us have taken this challenging task of documenting languages. It's a fairly new discipline, but it's a very challenging field, because the whole purpose of documentation is to inform society how a speech community uses its language in myriad fields and occasions. Once a language becomes a sleeping beauty or is on the verge of vanishing from the logosphere, correct and appropriate documentation has the possibility of its revival, provided the community is willing to do so. Like Great Andamanese are not willing to revive their language, so it was very difficult, it is very difficult to revive it there. So the big and the most significant purpose of language documentation is that endangered languages can be revived. I will now come to the some of the works that I shared with the, Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan very often, because of my extensive and as much intensive as I could do on the islands of the Andaman. You know, there are 550 odd islands in the Bay of Bengal, combined Andaman and Nicobar, and well, I visited very few, but the indigenous cultures of the Andaman Islands have already been subjugated for centuries by colonial and political and epidemiological and environmental pressures, because we have been bringing in diseases, we have been cutting the forests, and many other pressures that it has been subjugated to. However, when I visited the Andaman Islands in 2001, I would not imagine that my exploration would turn into a gold mine, allowing me to identify the sixth language family of India and very unique linguistic structures representing perhaps the possible structures in the evolution of human language. And my identification of the sixth language family was later on corroborated by population geneticists, so that gave me a very good motivation to dig deep into this language. And this is the view of that That comma-shaped island that you see is a straight island where I spent large number of time in the jungle living with the Andamanese whenever JNU allowed me to go and take leave, and also all my vacations, whether winter vacations and summer vacations, were spent there. So this was my Karam Bhumi, actually. And I remember that Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan asked me a lot of questions on Strait Island. This is the map of human migration that shows that Andamanese came on this island 70,000 years ago from Africa. So the migration started 70,000 years ago. I'm sure by the time they came to Andaman, it was 55,000 years ago. So they are one of the oldest living civilizations, whatever the nature of life is on this earth. So you can see the migration route out of Africa reaching the Andaman Island. Let me see, I think I have something here. See, so this is, in India, they reached 70,000 years ago. So this is one of the oldest. One of a very short picture of communities, you know, members of these, whoever were there in Strait Island that day. So we snapped this picture. I actually happened to study all the three languages, Onge, Jarawa, and Great Andamanese, but Sentinelese, of course, as you know, is inaccessible, so I could not. And the study had been, going on since 2001, and this is only up to 2009, but after that, I also continued this. This is one of the corroborated study that the geneticists did by showing that there is two different haplogroups of Great Andamanese and Onges, after I did I published my results that they belong to two different families. Anyway, coming to the grammar, as I said, we know linguists actually grapple with the grammar of language to unearth much information. I will give you a very interesting aspect of the grammar of the Great Andamanese, which is very unique. Initially, I used to say rare, but then I had the opportunity to look into other Aboriginal languages of Australia, America, and other, and I realized, and with also talking to my fellow linguists, I realized it is really a unique structure. Because the uniqueness comes by the anthropocentric system. Great Andamanese actually see everything, perceive everything through human body. And this is very important to know, that everything is connected to human body. So how do they do it? They initially divide or they classify the human body into 7 different divisions. And each division is, right now it's very abstract, monosyllable, but I'm sure it must have been some words to begin with. So 7 different sounds actually represent 7 different divisions of body, and each division has several body parts. Look at the next slide, and that will show you that how they decided, So the A marker refers to mouth and also origin. And in the picture next to it, you can see it has been drawn as a... the laser I'm trying to. It's okay, never mind. So the. Okay. So the A, which is the number one zone, and marker is A, relates to mouth and origin, and you see only this portion, the mouth and origin, that is, so the lips. Not the lips, sorry, the tongue and the palate and some parts of the mouth are represented by A. Then air, the number two, refers to the external body parts, and the external body parts are colored in blue, and then it only up to the wrist, shoulders, and the most of the facial features are represented by air. And then there is Ong, which is number three for extremities. So the fingers, toes for the extremities is Ong. And A is for the internal organs, and there I also do not understand why there is a division, but anyway, the number five, the intestines are basically, it is represented by A. And Ara is generally refers to sexual organs or sides and round shapes. So number six, the large intestines and other spleens and stuff is represented by six. And O is related to the legs and so on and so forth. So this puzzle, because I could not crack the grammar of this language for many, many months, and there was no other study which was done extensively on it. Anthropologists in 19th century did some study on the languages, and I did refer to the field notes of Portman and Hoffman and Horace Mann in Royal Anthropological Museum of London, but they were anthropologists, they were not linguists, so they could not put two and two together, really, that how these body division markers refer to the parts of the division markers of the body, and more important is that then every this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 divisions are associated to all the words in the language. So you know that you have nouns, verbs, adjectives, adverbs. These are the various parts of speech. Every part of speech in this language is associated, is obligatorily prefixed by these markers. That means they see those actions, those nouns, those adjectives, or the quality through their body. And this was a very interesting aspect, and as I said, it took me a while to crack the puzzle, because once I did, then I realized it was so systematic. And this table gives you some kind of a systematicity. For example, let me see. Yeah, look at this. This R, we just saw, it relates to mouth and origin. So for mouth, it's aphong. And once, if somebody is greedy, it's a kind of an activity which has concerns mouth, right? Because somebody is greedy, then his saliva comes from the mouth and so on and so forth. So he is known, the word is ajom. So jom is the word, but then it has to be prefixed by a. And that's the interesting part. Similarly, verbs, under the verb, you have to keep quiet. And keep quiet is again a phenomena which has to do with the mouth. You have to keep quiet. So that the verb to keep quiet is preceded by this prefix a. And similarly, the number two, number three, this is interesting. Air is for external body and parts. So if somebody is beautiful or somebody is ugly, you have to say air bungoi, or here you have air bungoi. But if somebody is beautiful inside, that means somebody is very nice, then you have to use number five, because then it will become a bungoi, not air bungoi. And that's why I was very much puzzled that why one word in this language takes so many different forms. And it looks like something like prepositions, but then it is not a SVO language, there could not be prepositions, and that's why it was difficult to crack the puzzle initially. And so on and so forth, you know, this is very interesting that if you look at this chart of all the words that the language has, is always prefixed by some or the other body part. Now the question is, which are those words which are never preceded by these? The words which refer to environment. So flora and fauna and anything has to do with environment is not preceded by these prefixes. But these internal, external, and as you can see, number five, number six, the old people is also since this ara is for the round body parts, I was quite amused to see that old people are also called aratob. And I asked them why, they did not know, but I can understand that old people, you bend your back and you take a rounded shape. So that must be the reason. So it is not surprising that the world view of an early society could be expressed through the human body. The primary reference and primordial reference points were the body and its divisions. And each division of the body encapsulates zones or parts. Not only that, even any kind of a noun also has to be specified for its location. So for example, if the blood is coming from your fingers, then it is ong tei. Tei is blood. But if the blood is coming from the forehead, it is er toi. If the blood is coming from the feet, then it is o tei. So the very word blood also has to be prefixed by what location, what part of the body it is coming from. And even the marks, if somebody shoots an arrow at you and you leaves a scar, then depends which place of your body has been scarred, according to that, it has been classified. So this was a very interesting aspect of the grammar, which actually exposed me to the world view of the community and how they relate themselves to the world and how do they perceive the world. So the linguistic structure alone provides a glimpse into an ancient worldview in which the macrocosm reflects the microcosm. And everything that there is or happens inextricably connects to everything else. And this is a very abstract philosophy, but this is what the great Andamanese grammar emotes. I have a feeling that the early possible, this unique linguistic structures of great Andamanese language family perhaps have traces of possible human language in the speech of the early colonizers of South and Southeast Asia. And the grammar and the language also led me to collect the oral tradition of the community. And this was rather challenging because, when the language is on the verge of extinction, people forget narrations first. And most of the people that I asked for narrations, they said, 40 saal se kuch suna nahi, aapko kya sunayega? I've not heard anything for last 40 years, what can I tell you? And narration has to do with the grammar, because you cannot construct a sentence unless you know the grammar. So the narration was almost lost. So I had to spend a lot of time with my main person, whom I call my guru, now junior, as you can see his picture here. And Boa Senior, who was the last speaker of Bo, she sang several songs for us because, the songs reside in your memory. People do not understand the meaning, but the songs do reside in your memory. And the biggest example is your diaspora community living in outside India. They still remember their old songs, whether they come from Bhojpur area or other areas, but they may not know the meaning of it. But to narrate a story, it was a difficult task. But somehow, I convinced now junior, and one by one, the story started pouring in, and I collected 10 stories, which are given in this book, Voices from the Lost Horizon, with translation, and also the songs are given with the Devanagari Lipi, because I gave that script to that language because I wanted Andamanese children to read their songs and memorize them. The interesting aspects is there are two creation tales. And that one of the creation tales is of Pherta Jido, which is a very amazing tale because this is it's a very complex story of ethnogenesis. We are informed of Panch Bhuta as well as Nirvana. And mind it, I'm not talking of Vedas. I'm talking of a language which pre-existed Veda many thousand years ago. So here you have these concepts. And the now junior thought that was the biggest love story he had ever heard. So I'm happy to see that It's displayed outside the book. You can have, if you have time, you can go through it. Then there's another story which came out as a creation story. Also was the Jiro Mithe. Jiro was a name of a tribe. Mithe means dove in Andamanese language. And this came out because once I saw Boa Senior talking to birds in her Bo language. And I said, why are you talking to birds? She says, don't you know nobody else understands me, but they are the only ones, they understand me. I said, how come? And she says, don't you know birds are our ancestors? And I said, can you tell me the story? And they said, no, I don't remember the story, you ask now. And when I asked now junior, he said, yes. You know, these junior seniors, I'm mentioning it's very odd, but this is how the Britishers named them. And they have continued this legacy because there was a now senior who was somebody else, and so on and so forth. So now junior said, yes, I remember the story, but you have to give me a couple of days because I have to really think in sequence. You won't believe he finally came out with Jiro Mithe, which is an amazing story, how Andamanese became birds. No wonder I collected 97 names of birds because, I mean, this is, he was saying, don't you know there are so many names of birds because they are all Andamanese. They were all Andamanese. That's why so many names. Because I told now that I don't remember more than 10 names of the birds. How come you remember so many? He said, because they are all Andamanese people. So, you know, this is a very interesting story. It came, this is also kind of a creation tale. And, but the Phertaji, though, the first story that it took me whole 1 year to elicit, line by line, word by word, because it took me a lot of time. He had forgotten. He would sometimes tell in me in Andamani Hindi. Then he'll say, no, this is not a good translation. Let me think, I'll tell you in Andamanese. Then he will tell me in Andamanese. Then he would look for a translation. So, you know, this process of eliciting data from a language which is on the brink of extinction actually got revived. And he was so keen to tell me more stories, but I did not know that he'll leave this earth so soon. I told him I'll come back again, but by 2010, both now junior and Boa senior left this earth. So we are completely, the India lost a very treasure and in the loss of these two community members. Right now, there are only 3 members left in the Great Andamanese community of 70, 80 people who remember their language. They also do not speak well because they said, we don't speak at all among us. That's what I was telling is when the domain of language is shrunk, then language becomes a sleeping beauty, as Zuckerman says it. To conclude, what I had been saying is that human language serves as a missing link in the puzzle of human evolution. Languages evolve and grow in layers. At one point in time, one can witness different layers of grammatical and lexical items. Lexical items means words, superimposed on each other, just as layers of different civilizations that must have existed at different times are found by archaeologists while excavating sites. Linguists can reconstruct protoforms, the older forms, and identify various stages of development by scientific methods. Language evolves gradually over a period, being influenced by biology, genetics, social systems, cultural beliefs, migration, displacement, and contact. There's a strong interlinkage, as you must have realized by now, between ecodiversity, perception, cognition, and the language that is used for its coding. It is this coding that is available at different stages of language evolution, representative of the culture, the worldview, and the history of the speech community. It is our task to excavate these linguistic archaeological remains for information as to what we were, with whom we came into contact, and how we coexisted for the survival of humanity. Thank you. नीचे जाऊं ऊपर ही
Would you like to have the mic in your hand?
Yeah, sure. But,
Well, friends, before we conclude with the remarks of Professor Subhash Malik, I think I should thank Anvita ji for having given us a very brilliant and insightful presentation on what is disappearing. It also becomes willy-nilly a metaphor for what is happening in our own times, not necessarily in those remote areas, but right here. A lot of Delhi is disappearing, in some sense. Monuments are disappearing. People with monumental memory are disappearing. And there are we who watch this helplessly, doing nothing about it, not even recording it properly, perhaps. So these are difficult times when very little is created, a lot is destroyed. And that was one of the concerns of Kapila ji, if I may say so. She was concerned about what was disappearing, because there was what was disappearing had something deeply imaginative, creative, and interrogative. And we are being thrown into the lap of uniformity. Anyway, so thanks once again. And may I now request Professor Subhash Malik to say the final words.
Well, thank you so much. And very grateful to Anvita ji for this brilliant, this thing, so very beautiful. So what I can say is that what is your and my identity? It's language. Without language, we won't exist as individual beings. So this is the importance of the language and what she studied and talking. So I think this is a very crucial thing. We don't think we are the language. We are the language. Our individual identity is language. Without language and words, we will not be existing. So that's my view, which you can take it for what it is, but that's the importance of language. You and I exist in language. We have no other existence. If there's no language, no thoughts, there'll be nothing left. So, and I must thank Mr. Borker for inviting me. I don't know why he did, but very kind of you to do that. Very nice, very grateful. Thank you.
Play the national anthem.
We sing ourselves then? Or?
We can.
What are we standing for, please?
I can't hear.
Memorial lectures, by convention, do not end with question answer.
Whose convention? We should be allowed to ask some questions. This is a very interesting speaker.
Yeah, can we set a new precedent in the fond memory of Sri Kapila Vatsyayan?
You don't have to set a
new precedent. Just one question.
Anyway, let's all sit down and let's,
we're still alive.
There are some pressing issues which need to be addressed immediately after this. So that's why I think we are short of time. But I have given my email address.
Better we give up its capital.